Hey everyone, Rodney here at Cleves Tech, and today I'm going to show you how to do better text and also tattoos. Now, I've done previous videos on similar subjects, but I've found a little bit better way of doing it and wanted to show you. These techniques can be used for more than what I'm showing, so even if you don't need to create tattoos, you can still benefit from knowing how this works, and it may give you ideas on how to use it for other things. And don't forget to check out my other videos as well. So for anybody that's seen some of my previous videos I've done on this, this is an improvement on that those methods. And this can be applied to more than just things like, well, text on signs or other objects. These can be applied to poses. It can be applied to a lot of things, or tattoos as well. So that's what I'm gonna show you today on this video, is how to do like a display screen on a robot, and then I'll show you how to do a tattoo afterwards. The tattoo is a little bit more difficult. The text itself is the easier part. So we'll do the screen first. So I've gone ahead and generated some images here. Now I am going to be using the Mohawk checkpoint, but this works with most checkpoints. Some do better than others, I find, when it comes to some of the inpainting, when it comes to the tattoo especially. For this, I've already gone ahead and upscaled the image, because I find it's better to upscale the image before you do some of these effects, because once you go to upscale, it'll mess up some of these things. So you want to get your image to more of its final state, and then you can inpaint those areas, because we're going to be inpainting smaller areas. So this works fine on upscaled images. So we have our upscaled image already in here. We're going to mask off, and we're going to do the display screen first, and then I'll show you the tattoo afterwards. So let's just mask off the area we want here. So that's our masked area. Now, the other thing we need to do is in the advanced tab here, we're gonna go into the developer debug mode. And one of the first things you wanna do and not forget, because if you start getting results that aren't even close to what you want, things don't work, then this might be what you forgot to do, is mixing image prompt and inpainting. The problem is with doing this normally is if you don't do this right, things won't line up. And that was in my previous videos, I showed you how to figure out roughly where they were gonna be. But I've actually found a better way of doing that. It eliminates a lot of those initial steps and it makes the work a little bit easier. Now we're gonna go over our inpaint tab after we've done that. And in here, for this screen that I'm gonna be working on, one of the settings we wanna pay attention to is this inpaint respective field. Now, if we go ahead and generate now and work on that, it works with most of this image, which makes it very difficult when working with small text. That small text will not stay together and it will just come out as a jumbled mess. So we need to slide this down. I'm gonna slide it way down to about a 1 point. Now let's just go into this area here, about one. You'll figure out roughly where you need to be for what you're working on. If we go ahead and do this and it's not zoomed in enough, I can zoom in even more. So now that I've changed that inpaint respective field, we're also go up. Now this step is different from one of my previous videos because this is the shortcut that I found. If we click off debug inpaint preprocessing the first time we go to do it, once we have our area set up, then we just hit the generate button. We're gonna get Fooocus to do the work for us and to show us exactly where everything's gonna be so we can use that. So now it's provided us the images that we need. We can download these images. So I'm gonna go ahead and download these. The top right, click on the download button. I'm gonna download this image, and you don't always need the mask, but sometimes the mask can be useful when you go to put the text and stuff, I'll show you. So we have those two images. Now, if it was straight on text and it wasn't at a slight angle, like this one's gonna be at an angle, so I need some perspective, then I could use a basic editor. But if you're trying to do text at an angle, you're gonna need something that can do perspective. GIMP is what I've normally used in the past. It is free and open source. Today, you can use Photoshop, obviously, or a lot of the tools can do it. Today, I'm gonna be using Pixlr. I'm using the free, I'm not signed in or anything. So we're gonna open that up. Now I'm gonna bring my image in here to start with. So this is my base image to start with. And then I can bring in the other image if I want to. Well, that didn't work. Okay, so we bring in our other image. I'll add to it, and I'm gonna bring that opacity way down. Now, in this image, I probably don't need to do that because I know where the text is gonna be. But depending on what you're doing, sometimes it can be useful to have that slight guide there. So now that we have this set up, I'm gonna add some text in here, a new text layer. Let's do Toaster 3000 repair service menu. Okay. Now I'm gonna change the text to black because I find it works best black on white usually, but you can try it the other way. You get different results depending on that. But I usually go with black. I find it works better when you're trying to generate. Let me change the font on here. Let's go with something a little thicker. Now we'll go with bold. Bold, thicker, bolder font. Usually gonna stay together better when you go to generate it. And sometimes putting a little bit of the letter space can help so the letters don't merge. Now, once we have our text ready and the right size, at this point, I'm gonna go ahead and rasterize this layer. And now I can go up to edit and I can go to free distort. Depending on the tool you're using, GIMP, it's perspective. I'm not sure in Photoshop, but, and then we can drag this and we can just get our text under here to roughly the perspective. Okay, so now we have our text where I want it. I'll hit apply. And then I'm just gonna create an empty layer. I'll disable the other layers. And then I'm gonna fill this layer white and drop it in the back. So now we have our text. And I'm gonna go ahead and save that image. Okay, we've saved our image. And now we will go back into Fooocus and we're gonna drop, go to the image prompt tab now. And you wanna make sure you have the advanced checked off down at the bottom. So if you haven't done that, check that off. Then in that first one, we're gonna drop the text that we're gonna be using. I'm gonna set this over to CPDS. I find that works better. Pirate Canning can work as well. You can experiment with the two of them. And then I'm gonna add a prompt in here. Okay. I find if you add the text that you're using up here in the prompt as well as in the image prompt, you're gonna get better results. Things will stay together better. Go back to our inpainting. We have everything set there. We have our respective field. We do not wanna change this. Once you have gone ahead and set everything up, you do not want to change that inpaint respective field because that can mess up all the alignment and everything else and things won't look right. So, but we do want to go up and uncheck the debug inpaint process pre-processing because we've already got the images. Now we'll go ahead and I'll just generate some images. Okay, we have our display screens. Let's see how those came out. We'll pull those up on a different viewer. Well, not too bad. It got extra text, but we could go back if we want to and get rid of that. Oh, there, that's the one I like. That's the one I'm settling on. That's the one I like. Okay, now for the tattoo. That one's a little bit more difficult and can be more hit or miss. I find these sorts of things are pretty simple at this point. And once you've done enough of them, you can do quite a few. But like I said, you do want to wait until after you're done with everything else. Once you get the rest of the image, then go in after you've upscaled and everything is, I find, the best solution. Now, as far as the tattoo one goes, it's mostly the same process, but we have to tweak a few different things to get it to blend in a little bit better. So we'll go ahead, we're gonna do the same thing. So first, I'm gonna get rid of this from the image prompt. So we have to decide where we're gonna put this tattoo. Well, I'm just gonna put it right here on the arm, because why not? Okay, so we've marked off where we're gonna put the tattoo. Now, the other thing we need to do is the same idea, the inpaint respective field. I'm gonna leave that probably in the same range. That seemed to work pretty good the last time. So we'll leave that same idea. And we do need to go in and check off the debug inpaint pre-processing again, because we do want to generate those images. So let's go ahead and generate them. Now let's go ahead, I'll download this image, same as before. And I'm gonna down this one as well. May or may not need it. These I do find it's better to have that mask. Now in this one, I'm gonna do this in Adobe Express. So let's see here. Just gonna bring my image in. There we go. Then I'm gonna bring in the other one. I'll put that right on top. And then I'm gonna lower the opacity. Now I know where that tattoo is gonna be. That's all. It makes a good guide. Now I need to bring in what I'm gonna use for my tattoo. Here we go. Voila, there's our tattoo. Generated that earlier. And we'll give it a slight angle since the arm's at a slight angle. That looks good. Now, of course, we want to add some text to make this even better. So we'll go ahead and add some text. There we go. That's our tattoo. So once we have everything lined up how we want it, I'm gonna go ahead at this point and I'm gonna get rid of these layers, the opacity. So now I just have the white background. We're gonna go ahead and download that. I find overall, usually the white background gives the best results. I find sometimes though, you can try doing it without a background color as well. Okay. So back to our image here. We're gonna uncheck the debug inpaint preprocessors, get that done. And we're gonna go over to our image prompt area like we did before. And we're gonna bring in our tattoo. Now, if I wanted to keep the colors the same, I could bring in the original image. You know, if I wanted to, I could bring in that image to help influence it just as the image prompt, but I'm not gonna for this one. I don't care as much about the coloring. And I find it works better if I let it make its own decision on that. So, and I do find the CPDS usually works best, but you can try both because sometimes depending on the image and everything else, one works better than the other. So we have everything else set here. We haven't touched our inpaint respective field, but we do now with the tattoos, the one thing I do want to do, I find works better for blending things together. And it gives it the more faded in look is the inpaint denoising strength. Because if we regenerate now and hit generate, it completely regenerates that whole section. But if we lower this down, it leaves a little bit of that original image underneath. The lower you go, and I've talked about this in previous videos that I've done on this, if we were to go way down here, it wouldn't do much because it's gonna keep most of that original image. It might get a slight faded look of this image, but we're gonna keep this pretty much way up there, like in the 0.8 or so. And we can adjust that depending on how we want that to look once we start generating and seeing how it comes out. Let's go ahead and generate this and see what it looks like. Okay, so we have to change this. I forgot to change the prompt. That's a little bit better. So tattoo on woman's arm of a robot and text, I like toasters. And we're gonna see if this comes out better because that definitely did not come out good. So our tattoos are done. Let's pull some of these up and see how they came out. Well, as you can see with this one, the skin didn't get blended in well perfectly. And one thing I do find sometimes with these is they'll be a little bit red, like it's a brand new tattoo. That is one thing that I see quite a bit of. I think maybe it was trained on too many images of fresh tattoos. But usually if you do a few, you'll get a much better blending, like this one blended in pretty well. Now the other option you have at this point, we can go in as well and we can reduce this. And we'll see how this, I'm gonna reduce this down a little bit more just to give you an idea of some of the differences of how this will come out. Let's hit generate again. Let's pull those up. Now, sometimes it will add extra text. You can go back and use inpainting to remove those if you want, or to touch things up when it comes to the blending. But usually I sit here and I'll, you know, if we were to drop this down even more just to see what the difference is. Let's go down to 0.55 just so I can give you an idea of how these work differently and how that impacts the resulting generation. Let's look at these. Now this is, I think I got the results that I was trying to get. Like this one here, you'll notice, but it's very faded. And the reason is because it's keeping a lot of the original image, the arm there. So that's why we're not getting the, you know, the definition. And it really doesn't necessarily blend in better. It's just a matter of trying to find, honestly, I find around 7 or so, really depends. The higher you go up, the newer the tattoo will look, the brighter and things like that. So if you want it to not look quite as bright, and this goes for the same with some other stuff, like when I've done it on t-shirts and clothing, you want to have some of that underlying image bleed through a little bit. So that's why you want to find that right number in here. I find usually between 7 and 8 a lot of times for a lot of these things is really what works the best. But it does take sometimes a bunch of image generations to get them the good ones that will blend in with the skin and everything well. So don't go in expecting to generate 2 to 3 images and they're just going to come out right. With enough playing with it, you can get some pretty decent results. Okay, so we got a few more. As you can see, it's a mixed result. And out of all the images, I got a couple that were pretty good. Like for myself, if I was going with it, I'd probably just go with this image. I do like it overall. It blends in pretty well. I could go in and touch things up afterwards if I really wanted to be picky about it. Well, that pretty much covers what I wanted to show, and I do hope this video gives you more options when it comes to creating things with Fooocus. And don't forget, this technique can be used for much more than just the things that I'm showing here. And I'd love to hear in the comments of ideas that you may have used this for. If you found the video helpful, please do consider hitting the like button because it does help get the video out to more people. I also do have a Patreon if you'd like to help support the channel. And I do have limited time and lots of testing goes into these videos, and I'd love to keep making as many as possible. Thanks for watching and have fun creating.